many of us sometimes question whether we're actually losing pieces of ourselves amid all the hate and the vitriol and the struggle and the rejection, questions of identity, the stuff going on politically. Do you find it increasingly difficult to stay connected to reality? Experience. Do you find it difficult to stay connected to something that's real, that's experiential, that you say, wow, that grounds me, that helps me, I'm alive in that? Something that consistently reconnects you to your faith, your values, and the essence of who you are. I stumbled across a song by one of the winners of The Voice. His name's Jordan Smith. This song has brought me again and again to tears, and it talks about this struggle that I've just described. I want you to listen to it before we go on.
Don't wanna put you aside, couldn't leave you on the shelf. No, that wouldn't be right. I can see it in your eyes. You've forgotten how it felt to live on the other side. How long is too long to have not moved on? I don't wanna settle for second best. Gonna fight for you till there's nothing left. I don't wanna settle just because I'm scared. When the lights go out and the darkness dares you to settle, I don't wanna settle. Behind, they turn you into someone else. There's no reason for you to hide. If you need something to believe, look beyond what you can see, past the mountains we've yet to climb. How long is too long to have not moved on? How long too long to keep holding on? I don't wanna settle for second best. Gonna fight for you till there's nothing left. I don't wanna settle just because I'm scared. When the lights go out and the darkness dares you to settle, these chains off of yourself. Don't you know you were born to fly?
Have to confront our darknesses, our shadows. You can't pray them away. They're here for life. I didn't used to accept that. I thought if I was a good enough Christian, if I tried hard enough, prayed deeply enough, got up early enough to bone up on my prayer, went to church several times a week, read my Bible. Maybe that's why I don't read it as much, because I can't talk. Can't read either. My wife knows I can't spell, so I'm just a mess. But I'm confronting my shadows, because I realize that no matter how much effort I put into it, the return is you're going to have shadows. There's a line in this lyric that Jordan sings. It goes like this: when darkness dares you to settle. That's a challenge. And I submit to you, there are things in your life every day that are just daring you to give up, to lay down, to not be your best self. And courage isn't the absence of fear. It's the determination to face your fears head on. Again, I used to think that if I was a good enough Christian and if I applied the Bible right and I prayed hard enough and I said the right words when I confessed the scripture and held to those promises, that I could get rid of fear, I could get rid of the shadows, so on and so forth. And that's just not realistic. Let me ask you, what might be the most famous psalm? If I just said so, what psalm comes to your mind? Just real quick, without even thinking about it. And what's like the most famous psalm, even for non-Bible readers, non-Christ followers? Psalm 23. Everybody knows Psalm 23, right? At least by title. What we may not know is what David said in there about shadows in our life, about falling apart, and how God handles that in our life. Verse 4 and 5, even in the unending shadows of death's darkness, I am not overcome by fear. You are with me in those dark moments. He didn't say, thank you, Jesus, for removing all dark moments. He said, you are with me in those dark moments, near with your protection and guidance, and I am comforted. Watch this. You spread out a table before me, provisions in the midst of attack from my enemies. King James Version says it this way: in the presence of my enemies. You prepare a table for me in the presence. He's not getting rid of your enemies. He's not going to push them behind a curtain where you can't see them anymore. It's not that you won't have any shadows or difficulties. He's just going to set you up right there in the middle of it with a table and provide. That'll change your prayer life. That'll change your attitude and your outlook. So, Paul said, persevere in trials. James picked up on that and said, look, tests and trials come your way. They're just part of living by faith. He said in the very first chapter of his book, verse 12, blessed is the one who perseveres under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised to those who love him. There are circles in which I wouldn't be accepted for this next comment. Circles I used to run in. Again, because of this overt hyper faith of triumphal living and triumphalism, and nothing can ever be wrong, there can never be any shadows. So here goes. Faith embraces brokenness. Faith embraces brokenness. You say, I'm not broken. You're just not old enough yet. Hang on. I was looking at a teenager here. You're just not old enough yet. Now, see, it's one thing to throw these kind of things out as, well, this is my religious belief. But it's another if Jesus taught it, or if Jesus said it, or if Jesus lived it. If Jesus was the pattern for it. John's Gospel, chapter 12, verse 24 through 26. Verily, I say to you, unless a kernel of wheat falls to the ground and dies, it remains only a single seed. But if it dies, it produces many seeds. Anyone who loves their life, they're going to lose it, while anyone who hates their life in this world will keep it for eternal life. Now, it isn't the focus of this message to exegete eternal life and who's in, who's out, and all of those kind of questions. I am interested in the fact that Jesus was talking about himself and said, look, I have a choice too. I can remain alone, shout the victory, call 10,000 angels to come deliver me off the cross, go back to the Father, have a good life, and not deal with this. Or I can accept the fact that the path to resurrection and victory is always death. It's always going into the ground first. It's a pattern. Jesus said, look, I'm a kernel of wheat. And you might get one meal from that, but if I go into the ground and I die, it's going to change the universe. Do you want to be a world changer? Or just a rotten seed? These things are coming to me right now just as I'm talking. It's not even in my note. I don't like to. But I'm sorry for calling you out, my brother, but you can take it. He's a man's man. Yeah. He's over here making muscles. See, I think there's a mystery to suffering. I think there's a mystery to blessing. My wife got a phone call yesterday from a life, well, she got a call, I think it was 2 days ago, from somebody who knew this individual, who was a lifelong friend of my wife's. And this friend informed my wife that this person had passed away. And then yesterday, her husband called to chat with my wife, knowing and understanding and appreciating their friendship. Why? The reason I bring that up is because this couple is a couple of faith. They taught me faith. They were the associate pastors to my pastor, who put most of the, quote, faith ministries or word of faith churches and ministers of the past 30 years on the map, published all their books. And this gentleman and his wife were their associates. My pastor and wife were their associates. They knew faith. They knew victory. They knew how to pray, how to study the Bible, how to confess properly the promises. And she passed away ill. She passed away of a disease. Now, I know they prayed. I know they stood. I know they believed God. And this is nothing against them. Trust me. I think there's a mystery to why it doesn't work sometimes. And I'm okay with that. I didn't used to be. Because I used to beat myself up that the reason it, quote, didn't work in this instance, she didn't get healed, was because I didn't pray hard enough. I didn't believe hard enough. I didn't say the right words. I wasn't reading enough of my Bible. All of that. It was a mess. It was such a delusion. And I don't know anybody in my life now or formally, and I'm talking about B, big names. I could drop big names who in their journey of faith hasn't gone through real shadows and darkness. And yet we used to teach that suffering was a result of me not getting it right. And I submit to you that suffering is part of shadows and brokenness in this life that come to rob us of our joy and our walk with Jesus. And you do not pray them away. You don't confess them away. You go and you get right down in the middle of them and then watch God prepare a table and provide. What am I talking about? Trust. I'm talking about trusting Him in deep, deep ways that you never have before, and accepting that there's mystery to sin. There's mystery to death. There's mystery to healing. There's mystery to suffering. Richard Rohr says this: it's much easier to appreciate the glory of Jesus, His resurrection, than His painful crucifixion. Yet, Mark's Gospel, written around 65 to 70 AD, focuses on Jesus's suffering servanthood. Christians believe that we are saved by the death and resurrection of Jesus. The key, however, is to put both of those together. Listen, we need to deeply trust and allow both our own dyings and our own certain resurrections, just as Jesus did. A kernel of wheat that goes into the ground. He knew it was coming. He accepted it. He didn't try to pray it away. He said, my life might be falling apart. There's pieces of me that are being ripped apart and ripped out of me. I'm okay with that. There's a certain mystery to it, but this I know. I can trust my Heavenly Father. I put my hand in His. And so I'm going to go ahead and accept the journey of both my deaths and my resurrections, plural. Don't you wish at least there were just one and like get it over? I'm looking at a brother right now and we're kind of smiling, and there's kind of an inside joke on this. It's not a joke, but I mean he's had his share of shadows. He's had his share of difficult times in every way, physically, financially, just lots of things. And Jeff, I think the last four phone calls where he's called me, all have been to report a praise report of something wonderful God is doing and how God has turned something around that used to be such a mess, such a, oh my God. And I'd hold his hand, or I'd pray, or we'd get together and say words of encouragement to one another. And it was kind of like, okay, I mean, trust God, brother. He'll bring you through it. You know how sometimes you share something with somebody and they just kind of pat you on the back and give you a few words and say, well, I'm praying for you. You know, it'll be better. It's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. But then there's that getting down at the table where your shadow makers are right there around you. And you look them all in the eye and say, I don't care what you say to me or how you try to steal my joy or my life, God is going to provide. This, Richard continues, is the full pattern of transformation. If we trust both, we are indestructible. Both what? Our dyings and our resurrections. It's a journey. It's a path. Jesus went through it. Don't try to pray it away. It is the pattern of life. This, he continues, is how Jesus saves us from meaninglessness, cynicism, hatred, and violence, which is indeed death. In fact, it's called the cruciform love of God, Romans chapter 5, verse 8. But God demonstrated His own love for us in this: while we were yet still sinners, Christ died for us. Death is the way to resurrection. Death is the pattern that Jesus embraced. You and I, we, is it you and me? Is that right? You and I? It'd be you and me. Oh, gosh, that's way too much to remember. My wife's over here quoting me all the grammar rules. And I'm a simple guy. I need simple explanations.
We need to have a talk. We need to have a talk about that. That's outright lying. Yes.
Wow. Just go ahead. You see, really what this amounts to is your true identity. Dying is part of our true identity in Christ. Don't get rid of that part. We talk about resurrection. We talk about answered prayers. We give praise reports. We talk about when everything's good, and we say, well, that's a result of me being in Jesus and close to Jesus. I beg to differ. It might be, but there's plenty of people that are experiencing wonderful things in their life, and they're no closer to Jesus than a wart on a frog's can. That also just came to my mind. You've got to embrace your true identity, which is a journey. Amidst struggles and societal labels, we find ourselves in Christ, passing through both death and resurrection. Galatians chapter 3, verse 26 through 28. For you are all children of God through faith in Christ Jesus. There's neither Jew or Gentile. There's neither slave or free, nor is there male or female, for you are all one in Christ Jesus. It's not who's in and who's out. You're all in. But boy, are we learning how to embrace and go through the times of shadow and deeply trust that God's going to prepare our table. Now, Jeff, you told us at the beginning that the title of your message was Dancing with Your Eyes, and I'm still trying to figure out what that has to do with anything that you've said. See, you're laughing because you've been sitting there thinking. You know, he told us this like title, Dancing with Your Eyes, and I don't get it because he hasn't said a thing about eyes or dancing. Okay, big fella. Here it comes. I want to show you a clip from a program called So You Think You Can Dance. We were watching one night and brought to tears by what I'm about to show you. Please.
This is so exciting for me.
What's your name?
So I'm Kaylee. I started dancing when I was 3 years old, and I'm 27 now. I was diagnosed with Ehlers-Danlos syndrome when I was 21, and I was told I'd never dance again. There's not a lot of research, but hopefully with me being a part of this, more awareness can come to this, maybe even a cure, because as of right now, there is no treatment or cure.
We can't wait to see a performance.
Thank you.
Cue music.
If someone told me that the world would end tonight, you could take all that I got for once, I wouldn't start a fight.
That was amazing. When you stood up, I mean, is that okay? Is this something you can do?
My doctors predict that I probably only have about 5 more years left of mobility at this level, but I feel more connected to myself as a human than I ever have. As I lose pieces of myself, I will dance until I'm dancing with my eyes.
I might need to take a minute. Is there anyone that doesn't apply to? Is there something so deep inside of you and deep about your faith and most of all, deep about simply trusting God that you can say, it might all be falling apart, but I'm going to keep dancing until the only part I can dance with is my eyes? And you two know something about that. I hate sickness. I hate cancer. I hate seeing people not being able to pay their rent. I hate it. And sometimes I drive away from a pastoral session with somebody and I say, God, why? And he reminds me I have to be okay with the mystery. But if I can encourage you to do what she's doing, if I can encourage you to utter the words and believe in the depth of your being that God's preparing a table for you, and that if necessary, you will dance till all you have left is to dance with your eyes. I promise you, he has never suffered the righteous to be forsaken or their seed begging bread. He will provide. I was told I'd never dance again. There she is. The doctors project I may only have 5 more years of mobility at this level. I feel more connected to myself as a human than I ever have been. Could you say that if you were in a wheelchair? Could you say that if your dream was to dance and you couldn't dance with your feet anymore, like all the other dancers that she'll be competing against? Would that be your attitude? What is it inside of a person that allows them to do that and come on a show like that and dance in their wheelchair and then say, I'll do this until all I can do is use my eyes? Job knows something about this. Yeah, that guy. The guy in the Old Testament who lost it all. He lost all his cattle. He lost all his livestock. He lost his farm. The hail came and beat everything to a pulp. Everything was white. He lost his children. Tim Hawkins, a comedian, said, but his wife was standing right over there. She remained. Just a bit of humor. He didn't lose his wife, and she became one of his critics. You're not serving God right, and that's why you're suffering. And Job for a while believed it, and then he tried to explain it away, and then he started accusing God. And it's not until the back of the book, Chapter 42, verse 5. Oh, I mean, I'm just going to tie this statement with the statement of, I'll dance until I can only do it with my eyes. Watch this. Here's Job. My ears had heard about you, but now my eyes have seen you. Talk about a mystery. You lose everything. And the one remaining, your spouse, and all your friends accuse you of being on the wrong side of God. writer of Hebrews, summarizes it all this way. Ponder, chapter 12. Ponder how he overcame, speaking of Jesus, all the odds stacked against him. This will boost your soul energy when you feel exhausted. Would you be willing to die for your faith? I've never been put to that test.